humming. Oh, it works. Okay. I'm not electronically good. Okay. But I was able to put this on. I learned. Welcome, everyone. And we have an extraordinary, wonderful afternoon to offer here at FIT. This is a special program, as you know, and I am the director of CL112. I'm Alice Papazian, a professor, I think. And we have here today, and this class is called Faces and Places in Fashion. It's a class that has been bringing the real world of fashion every Monday for many, many years. The contributors have been very generous and very notable members of the fashion world, each from different areas, so that you can learn and profit from their experiences and their way of having become successful. They are the inspiration at FIT. As representative of the real world of fashion, our president, Dr. Joyce Francis, I love Francis, Francis Brown, to introduce our most famous and notable guest speaker, Isaac Mizrahi. Please take the podium away from me, Dr. Brown.
First one that calls me Francis gets an F. I do. Thank you so much. Thank you. I'm delighted to be here with all of you. You know, one of the great benefits of an FIT education is that we draw on our strong ties with the fashion and design industries because it gives our students a unique learning opportunity. And this course, which was created by Professor Papazian, epitomizes that effort by bringing in speakers from industry's highest ranks, such as today's guest, Isaac Mizrahi. I can think of no one better qualified to give you a window on the fashion industry's challenges and expanding opportunities. Isaac Mizrahi's extraordinary career began in 1987 when he started his own clothing company. Just 2 years later, he won the Best Women's Designer Award from the Council of Fashion Designers of America and went on to win its prestigious Designer of the Year Award 3 times. Today, his ready-to-wear collection is sold at high-end retailers and specialty boutiques around the world. His couture designs are a favorite among celebrities and often seen on the red carpet. He is also the creative director of Liz Claiborne New York, overseeing design and development. In 2003, he made Target a fashion destination when he teamed with the retailer to launch a collection of chic and affordable women's clothing and accessories. And last year, he launched his lifestyle collection, Isaac Mizrahi Live, on the QVC Shopping Channel, and opened his first freestanding shop in New York City. It's very busy. He has created costumes for movies, theater, dance, and opera, and in 2002 received the Drama Desk Award for Outstanding Costume Design for his work on the play, The Women. And as if all that were not enough, he appeared in the film Unzipped, an award-winning documentary about the creation of his fall line. He won rave reviews in 1999 for his one-man off-Broadway show entitled Les Mizrahi. I like that. You cannot miss him on television. He's appeared on Sex and the City and Ugly Betty. He hosts his own series on the Oxygen and Style Networks and on Bravo's The Fashion Show. And as if to leave no stone unturned, in 2008, he published a book called How to Have Style, which is considered a must-have for every woman. So, he is just an unending whirlwind of creativity and achievement. We are only left to wonder how he will surprise us next. and as he continues to build on his extraordinary career. So we are indeed fortunate to have him with us today, and I thank you for being here. Isaac Mizrahi.
Oh, hi. Hello. Wow, I'm exhausted just listening to that introduction. I'm going to take my jacket off, I think. But, I guess we've segmented this presentation into three parts. The first part where I tell you about my history, and then we're going to show a little film, and then we're going to take questions, because usually I'm much better at answering questions than I am at just kind of speaking. So think of good questions, will you? And in order to sort of begin speaking about how I began in the fashion business, I should start from, I should start by saying that I don't really know how I started doing it. I just did it. I just started doing it. And at a very, very young age, I started doing it. I started sewing, I started making puppets, and then that's how I learned how to sew. And I actually have the advantage of being from New York and being from a family that has kind of roots in the apparel business. My father had a children's company. They manufactured children's clothes, and he had factories in the South and factories in the Free Zone in Dominican Republic and in Philadelphia. Anyway, and that's how I sort of learned how to sew. There were always sewing machines. And I went to High School of Performing Arts, which was sort of a really important step for me. It was an arts high school. At the time, it was on 46th Street, and I was an acting major, and I studied, you know, Shakespeare and all those great things. And then at some point, I chickened out and became a fashion designer because, you know, fashion is so much easier a business than show business, right? But I went to Parsons, actually. I didn't go to FIT, but I took evening classes here before I went to Parsons. I took classes in draping here, and I took classes, evening classes when I was in high school. Because at the time, my father's showroom was in this very prestigious building for children's clothing, and he was very good friends with this woman called Ellie Fishman, and I don't expect anybody to recognize that name, but she was a predominant, oh, you do, see, Alice knows who that is, but she was this fabulous children's wear designer in the 70s and the 80s and the 60s, maybe even the 50s. And, you know, I met her, and she looked at my sketches, and she said, oh, you should take evening classes at FIT while you're waiting, and then go from there, and she was right. And then I went to Parsons, and then I graduated, and before I graduated, I worked for Perry Ellis in, I don't remember what, it was 1980 or something. And that was sort of before interns, I swear. There were no such things as interns when I was in school. I just got a job there for the summer, and then I stayed on and worked for Perry Ellis, who was sort of my biggest guiding, fantastic spirit. He really did kind of have a very smart way of looking at things. He was very objective and could kind of look at something and change it just automatically and make it gorgeous or new or something, you know? He taught us all that. And he had an insanely beautiful taste in fabrics. And he used to leave us very much on our own until it was time to kind of make this judgment on things. And then he really kind of made stuff his own, you know? And flowers and just dinners and things. I mean, he was just very extravagant and wonderful and a good teacher. Perry Ellis was a good teacher. And he was born on the same day as my father, which is weird, right? It's a weird thing, but anyway, so Perry Ellis was my first thing. Then I went to work for Jeffrey Banks, who at the time was making a women's collection, and I kind of helped him with that. And it was a great job because it was really corporate, and I was left with the big responsibility of kind of forming a sample room, right? And now you don't even have sample rooms, which is sort of a shame, but in the old days you had these rooms with these beautiful ladies who were in late middle age who really knew how to sew, you know? And they used to sew these, they would compete with each other to sew beautifully. Now everybody sort of doesn't really sew beautifully. You have to beg people to sew beautifully. But in the old days, people just took real pride in sewing. And I learned a lot. I mean, I already knew how to sew before I went to Parsons. And I used to kind of complain to the teachers that they were holding me up, because they would hold me up. making me rip things. And I didn't like to rip things. I like to recut things. I don't like to rip clothes. I like to recut clothes, you know. But anyway, this is all a philosophy sort of situation. But so sewing, I learned a lot from those ladies. And then I went to Calvin. I worked for Calvin for quite a long time, for about 3 or 4 years. And it was fabulous. I met Grace Coddington there because she was the director of fashion at the time at Calvin, coming from British Vogue. And then I went on my own. I just stopped working. I quit. And after I quit, it was funny. I was on the phone with my mom, and she said, oh, you know, you have this trust fund. And I couldn't sort of believe that I had a trust fund. She said, you have a trust fund. And it was a very small amount of money, really. It was tiny, tiny. She said, you know, you could use that. What would you like to do? I said, oh, I'll buy an apartment. So I started looking at apartments, and then I was like, oh, no, maybe I'll start a company. I mean, it was like that kind of thing. So I found this friend of mine, and we'd been making clothes together for years. I'd been making clothes for her and for her friends, and her name was Sarah, and we formed this company and with money, with this money. And we, I actually painted the space myself. It was in Soho, which in 1987, when I got the space, you know, I mean, it was such a great place, Soho. I wish you could have known it. It was so unlike what you imagine it to be today. I mean, today it's just this awful kind of outdoor mall or something. But in the 80s, it was just amazing. It was this great, 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 exciting, artistic, fabulous place. It was paradise. And my space was like nothing a month. Like, I got paid for having this space, you know. But I actually built the cutting tables, and I made all of my patterns, and I made all of my clothes. It was really something else, such a immersion in something, you know. And I was so ready for it. I just couldn't think of working for anyone any time longer. And I think that's when you kind of know. You go, okay, I'm going to jump off the cliff now. Whether I fall and die or something, or if I fly, it doesn't matter. It really doesn't. And that's the point at which you know you need to kind of, you know, to move. So let's see. So I started, and I made clothes for about a year before I decided that I was going to have a fashion show. And I honestly, I never really, you know, there are people out there who will sort of go like, oh, you're so well connected or something, or you work that connection so well. And I don't really think about that. I don't. I remember there was one person said, oh, you're such a great PR agent. God, you're everywhere. And I thought, well, I don't have a PR agent. You know, I just kind of answer the phone and do my best, you know. And I always thought that it was sort of beside the point. You know, all that stuff is beside the point. It's really fun, but it is beside the point. And if it's why you want to go into the business, then you can forget it, because then you'll never find what you're looking for in this business, you know. But if it is a fun thing that helps you get reservations at restaurants that are hard to get reservations at, then by all means, you should keep doing it. But, you know, somehow I decided to have this fashion show, and somehow people heard about it, I swear, and just came. Everybody came to this show. And it was, we couldn't accommodate people. People were jammed into this little loft that was upstairs from my loft. It was a big loft, which was like, you know, the size of this stage, basically, right? That was a big loft. I mean, my loft was half the size of the stage, right? So we had the show, and I don't know, I just called Linda Evangelista because I knew her. And I called Christy, and I called, you know, Veronica, and I called Naomi, and they just couldn't think of not being in my fashion show. They just wouldn't think of it. It was a crazy, fantastic thing. I don't know why, you know? Because we liked each other, and it was fun, and, you know, it was just really fun and good, and that's what happened. I remember, like, Linda wouldn't come for the fitting. She said, well, if you come to my apartment, I'll do the fitting, but I'm not coming to your loft for the fitting. She was the one girl. I mean, you know, that's how things work, I think. That's how things really work in the world, you know? And then I had this fashion show, and I will never forget it. We had some guy spinning records, right? And somehow it didn't work, the system. It didn't work. So the show never really started. And then all of a sudden it started to work. But I was already like sort of sending girls out. It kind of had this fantastic effect. You know, it was like the girls started before the music started, right? And And I never looked up. I was so, like, my head was down at that first show. And it was the teeniest little space where the girls were changing, and they were knocking each other in the head. I mean, it was crazy. And I had gorgeous hair and makeup, friends of mine at the time, doing hair and makeup, and gorgeous jewelry that I did with this friend of mine. It was all just, really, my head was down. I was working, you know? I did not expect people to like it. I did not expect people to care about it. And somehow at the end, like, everybody was crying and screaming, and it was good. It was really good. But I remember thinking, like, oh, God, I didn't get that bow before she, you know, because it's the last time you will ever have to make that bow look beautiful, do you know? So, and it was a different, like, now you look at dresses, and all the bows are made on the dresses, and you just zip the thing up, and it's like, but used to be you'd have to make a bow. If you were an educated person, you learned how to make a bow, do you know? In the old days, zippers were not good things. Like, you know, Jeffrey Bean taught us that zippers were awful things and you should avoid them at most costs. Like, if you didn't need a zipper, it was a better dress, you know? And he was right. Now we kind of do zippers like with air quotes, like you see the zipper, it's part of the thing, you know what I mean? But there was a moment when you would think like an architect or think, not like an architect, I was never an architect, trust me, but I liked things that could somehow fold or wrap or, you know, just go on or something, more over the head. I'm much more kind of Isadora Duncan than I am, you know, Christian Dior or something. Much, much more about flesh. I prefer flesh than I do, you know, corsetry. But I do love a good corset, I have to say. I wish I could take questions now. I wonder if I could take questions now, because it's at this point, I don't really have that much more to say. Should I show a video first? Okay, why don't I show this video? I'm gonna sit down because it's really long, okay? All right, go video. Okay, so it's like day something, right? I don't know which day. It's like 2 days till the collection, and I feel much calmer today, and also we've begun our model fitting, so it's always soothing. But we still have no handbags, and we still have, like, not half of our shoes, which is making me nervous.
And they're stuck.
And somehow it's like fish and wildlife. That's all I hear about is, like, fish and wildlife and customs.
Right, right.
Fish and wildlife, yeah, exactly.
The Wildlife and Game, like, Administration.
Wildlife and Game Administration is holding my shoes up in Newark, New Jersey. Here's my process. I get inspired somehow, somewhere, from the ballet, from dance, from a movie, from something. I get this gesture in my head, and then I think, like, is this worthy of doing a whole collection? Usually it is, because it's the only thing I can think of. And from there, I just do all these millions of sketches about that one gesture.
That's a Chesterfield with the astrakhan trim.
And I work with Annika, they make patterns.
This would be Coyote, and that would be Beast, let's say, trim.
We make them out of muslin first. Muslins is this kind of like inexpensive thing that you make just to sort of see the shape and the exact balance of everything. Don't you want a bigger sleeve? I just want more here. Then we do like fabric fittings.
That would be much better, wouldn't it?
We book the girls, we plan the show, we plan the figures. And what gets annoying is actually when it becomes like a giant puzzle and things have to be taken out for certain reasons and things have to be added in this very kind of clever way, that's when it becomes a little bit grating on my nerves, because it's no longer about creating a look, it's about creating a show.
So there's no more day, there's no more so-and-so days till. It is the day of. And we were just having a really sort of in-depth intellectual conversation about dresses, about what dresses are, what they mean, and straight people versus curvy people, which is a fascinating conversation. And we're gonna sort of like host an online chat room about that subject soon or something, right? Seriously? But it looks gorgeous, and the hair and makeup looks gorgeous already. And a lot of the models are here already, which is shocking.
Yeah, they're early.
Some of the models are on time. That's the new breed of model. They're sort of making up for the sins of their ancestors. Making up for the sins of Naomi Campbell. All the new generation is paying for the sins of Naomi Campbell. They're all punctual.
Yeah, that's fine.
And that's my brilliant thought for the day. Except the collection, which is a brilliant thought, I think. But you decide. let's see, what should I blog about today? What could I possibly want to blog about today? Oh, wait, I got it. Why don't I talk about how exquisitely beautiful Michelle Obama looked last night at the State of the Union address, right? Wow. We should call this State of the Union dress, right? Get it?
sorry. Oh, God, that was fast.
She looked so beautiful last night, I thought. Forget the dress. The new bob is divine, right? The new bob is really gorgeous. Plus, the dress was pretty good, I must say. And I read something on a blog this morning that was very heartening, that people noticed, which was that it was the right dress at the right moment, which is what fashion is all about, right? It was kind of like the politics of the clothes. You know, she was saying, not left, not right. It was kind of like a bipartisan dress. Actually, George Stephanopoulos said how interesting that she's in kind of like a purpley color, which is a blend of red and blue, right? Love that. Then also someone said that it was kind of like plain and elegant as opposed to something frothy. It looked like the kind of dress that you'd want to roll up the sleeves and get to work. And I thought like, wow, all that, you know, from some silk and some knit, you know. Anyway, I was thrilled.
There are just things that happen in my life, like fashion shows happen. It's, I guess, the way certain moms or something think about cooking dinner, like there has to be dinner on the table, so it has to get done, you know. And at this point in my life, I work with so many great people, and my collaboration with them and the synergy of the different projects make each of the projects happen better. Do you know what I mean? I always thought that the more I do, the better I do at everything. Somehow, like, no matter what I do, whether it's the web show or TV or fashion or something like that, I always find myself in this position where I'm just sketching things crazily at 3 o'clock in the morning, having these ideas, having these design thoughts, you know? And so, like twice a year or five times a year or four times a year, whatever many times it is a year that I have collections, it's special because you're finally seeing the fruits of all of that design work, you know? And, you know, honestly, like, I don't know whether I like design more or fashion more. I tend to think I like to design a lot. And the fashion happens in spite of itself because I bore very easily, you know, and I go, oh, no, that's not fun anymore. That's fun now, you know what I mean? And also, my ear is to the ground as a fashion designer, you know, it's like you're feeling a certain kind of zeitgeist and you're kind of interpreting it in your own work.
Hi, so this is Glamorous. Blogging from Los Angeles. I don't usually blog from Los Angeles. I'm here for the past 3 days, and I have one more day here. I got here Friday, and I was on QVC. They had like these two special shows from Los Angeles, and one of them was for Lisa Robertson's 15th anniversary, and it was fabulous. Anyway, and now I'm backstage at Craig Ferguson, my little dressing room. I'm gonna go on very shortly, I think.
My first guest tonight is a beautiful and talented man. He's a fashion designer, he's a good friend of the show, he smells lovely. Please welcome the adorable Isaac Mizrahi, everybody. Isaac Mizrahi. Welcome, Isaac.
It's the gayest show. It's such a gay show, isn't
this?
It?
I like to think so.
It's a gay show.
Gay friendly.
Gay, no. Full on gay.
Full on gay?
It's not just gay friendly.
What makes it so gay?
Oh, I don't know. You, darling.
Oh, come on. Really?
Yeah. Hey, how's your wife?
Like, have you been doing any work? Have you been designing anything?
I don't work.
Oh, come on.
I'm like sort of the Charles Nelson Reilly of the modern day. All I do is go on your show and go on like talk shows. And
I love the idea of your Charles Nelson.
Yeah, I am. Me and Mo Rocca, you know who Mo Rocca is? We're sort of vying for positions
like
Charles Nelson Reilly of the modern day.
No,
it's true.
No, that's not true. You still have collections coming.
Wait, everybody at home is like Googling Charles Nelson Reilly because people don't know who these people are anymore. Ooh. Sorry.
What's going on?
I don't know.
What's going on?
Well, your leg is very accessible.
I know. Are you saying I'm provoking
yes,
you?
Yes, you're provoking me.
I'm provoking
me.
You with
you're
my leg.
You're provoking me. Yes. And by the way,
right?
No, I just, where else can I put it? If I had it over here, then the other leg would be there. That'd be a whole
That's
different
right.
thing.
Exactly.
Please welcome back to our show the always delightful and funny and intelligent and outrageous Isaac Mizrahi.
It smells heavenly here. I don't know what you're cooking, but it smells really good.
It always smells good
it
here.
It does.
Always.
Cooking something good on the show.
It's so good to have you here. You look great.
Thank you. So do you.
Thank you.
You look cute.
Thank you.
She looks good in jeans, doesn't she?
Do you approve of my outfit
yeah,
today?
Yeah, it looks really,
it's
really
okay?
cute. Mm-hmm,
okay.
Totally.
Danskin.
Wow. And I bet that has a really good neckline,
It does,
too.
And it's bodysuit. Mm-hmm. You know, I love bodysuits so much.
Also, she's wearing her collar slightly up. Just to frame the face, just a little bit, like bring the attention
undercollar
up to the face.
It's so pretty underneath.
Ooh,
it's so
beautiful.
Beautifully made.
Yes,
I love good
nice.
Tailoring.
Whatever. It's not Isaac Mizrahi. I have no interest in it.
Oh, here I am at the crack of dawn. On, is it Wednesday? It's
Tuesday.
Wednesday.
No,
it's Wednesday actually. Yeah, I've completely lost track of days because I work every single day at this show with no days off. Right. And from
the
crack of dawn till like a really late night call. The show is the fashion show, the Bravo fashion show. It's gonna be so great. Oh my God. The drama, darling, is building and building.
Coming up.
This outfit looks sloppy.
It becomes really impossible.
Who's more responsible for this outfit?
Well, I must say, Haven does shorts week after week after week. And I swear, this is like the first time they've looked spectacular. Now, Rico and Daniela, looking at that ensemble, the most unforgivable thing up there tonight was that pair of pants. Just the color alone
it was just ugly. The shape of those pants, it actually made the skinny model's hips look bigger.
They failed big time. Which means, Lydia, we're not buying your design. Bye-bye, darling.
We're going to take questions now, but before we take questions, I should say that it is interesting to see a person go from like being young and thin and cute to like old and fat and sort of. It's just clapped. Thanks, but it is interesting to see. I have a real kind of a message, which is that. I do think that design is much more important than selling things, obviously, you know? I mean, it took me this long to open a shop. I finally have like a shop where I sell my expensive clothes, and I'm finally letting go enough to like sort of create a business out of that, you know? But even when I made clothes for Target, it wasn't necessarily about just selling clothes, you know? It's like, I think the design of things, the make of something, the integrity that you imbue something with is way more kind of weighty and important than can be kind of judged by how many or how few you sell of them, you know? So as a creative person, you have to be tough-skinned and keep going in your career as an arbiter and as someone who sketches and adores textiles and colors, or whatever it is that makes you create the clothes or the objects, you have to love that much, much more than selling them, I think. You have to leave the selling of them to someone else. And that could be a great job, to actually think about selling things. You know, I mostly did that my whole life. And I feel like it's just now that I am surrounded by the right people who can take what I do and make it somewhat viable and commercial. But if you ask me to do that, I am way bored, you know? I am so bored by that. And I'm proud of the fact that I'm bored by it. And I'm proud of the fact that I, like, you know, don't have six houses in France or something. You know what I mean? I'm proud of the fact that I still live in a one-bedroom apartment and I have no children because I can't afford to have children. You know, seriously, it's like I am much happier as a person who really kind of does something just because I am interested in the paradigm moving or something. You know, it's like I will always have these expensive clothes. I will always have the fancy, beautiful things and those customers. But, you know, like making clothes for Target or QVC or something like that, it's really just about if it works, then good. You know what I mean? But it's just interesting to me to go on. Often, I'm discovering that you have to do something more than three times in order to get it to work commercially. You have to do it like seven times, you know? And by that point, I'm so bored, you know? So it's a good business, but it's a way better profession. You know what I mean? It's a way better kind of art form. I think it's an art form. I really do. I mean, if you were John Fairchild or if you were like sort of Anna Wintour, you might not call it an art form. You might call it some, it's a form of like applied art. Like you make it to sell it. Do you know what I mean? But not me. Not me. And that's like one of the first times I've ever gone out in public and said, I don't give a shit about selling things. So there. And neither should you. If you really want to do clothes, neither should you. And it's so funny, like me, I do t-shirts. I don't even do, you know, like bizarre things like they do in Paris. I don't like that either necessarily. Some of it I really like, but you know what I mean. It's like I don't do, like, every time I show a collection, I don't do bee-stung lips and, you know, raccoon eyes. I like girls to look beautiful usually. That's not because it's better. It's just because I like it. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. It's very complicated. And you know who taught me a lot about that? Someone I hate, who is your best teacher. Usually the person you hate the most is your best teacher. Vivian Westwood. She was so hateful to me once in Tokyo. I cannot even begin to tell you. Oh my God, she was so mean to me. But she was right. She was rigorously sort of kind of rigorously fighting for the right to do hideously ugly things. Do you know what I mean? And she's right, because oftentimes I like hideously ugly things too. You know what I mean? So it's like, but she was so nasty and so mean, and she was so right. And it was like, she's great because she opens this whole kind of like, what's the word? Vivian Westwood, like she really opens a dialogue of something. You know what I mean? And at the time I was with Lacroix and someone who's gone now, Moschino, and her in Tokyo. And they were so scared of her. And I wasn't scared of her, really. But I eventually became very scared of her. And she was very mean, but she was totally right. Do you know what I mean? It was smart, because it just teaches you that it's a game and you have to play it like a game. All right, so that's my crazy little inspired speech. Now, what are the questions? How long do we have for questions? I hope not too long, but okay. No, we have quite long. So who has a question? That lady up there. Can I tell you what? Upcoming projects, yeah, I will. I'll tell you that, you know, of course, aside from working on my collections, which are like cooking dinner, you know, it's like something that I never won't do. I do it all the time. I'm always thinking of dresses and things and fabrics and working on. I have a great bunch of people that keep me on a schedule of showing up to meetings and saying what I think. And I have to say, you know, for the most part, I really, I come to the meeting with a great deal of direction. I initiate all of my, every thought I initiate. That's not to say that we'll always stay that way, because it's funny, I work with young people and they do not see things the way I see things. And sometimes it's very smart to listen to them, because they care even less than I do about selling things. You know what I mean? And they care much more about what's stylish and what's of the moment. So anyway, so I continue to work on these collections, and I hope I'm getting more and more objective about that, right? But I'm also about to go to St. Louis in May for 6 weeks, and I'm gonna direct an opera, which I've been designing for about 3 years now. And I'm, you know, really scared, not of the work, but of leaving New York for 6 weeks, because I've never been away from New York for 6 weeks. Except to be in Paris or London or something, or, you know, working on something I was much more kind of easy about, like fabrics or something. But so I'm working on that, and then right after that, I have a spa collection to show. So I'm gonna be kind of, people are gonna be flying out of St. Louis working on that with me. And then after that, I have the fashion show season 2 to shoot, because that's gonna go again. And for this one, I'm gonna be an executive producer, so it's gonna be better. And then after that, I have a spring collection to show in the fall. So that's a lot of projects, wouldn't you? That's busy. I'm gonna be busy. And then I think I want a year off or something. Seriously, I want, like, when I'm 50 in 7 years from now, I would like to have a year off. What other questions are there? And also I'm gonna lose like 100 pounds. All right. Questions? Oh, go on. How much can you get for those earrings? Maybe you could sell those to raise some money. No, I'm just kidding. Someone who has no money. Have you worked in the industry? No, it's always good to work in an industry because you end up meeting people who take you to another level and another level. And finally, money becomes the last of your issues. You know what I mean? Like, if you have no money to start a collection, I think it's too soon. Does that make sense? I think you should kind of work for somebody and get into the industry, A, to see if you like it before you throw money at it, you know? And B, you'll see, money is the least of your issues. It's like when a girl wants to get pregnant or something and she can't figure it out and she doesn't want to do it. And then she adopts a child because she comes to this point and then she gets pregnant. Always. You hear about that so often. You know what I mean? I think it's exactly the same. It is. It's true. Question. Greatest accomplishment. I don't know. I haven't accomplished it yet, I would say. I haven't done it yet. I hope it's not Unzipped, is all I could say. Because, you know, I was very involved in that, and I fought to get that done, and it was such a crazy thing. And by the way, I think it's smart to, like, talk about that for a second, because, you know, it had very little to do with designing clothes, but it was really in us to do. I was sort of dating the guy who made that movie, right? And I'll tell you why it got made. It got made because I was supposed to do a charity show in Los Angeles. And again, you understand that, like, when you're making collections and when you're writing books and things, and things that are really of importance, right? Someone says, oh, do this charity dinner. You go, hell no, I don't have time for that, right? And then someone says, oh no, but you should, because it's such an esteemed thing, and Calvin did it last year, and da-da-da-da, and you go like, all right, well, maybe I'll think about it, but the only way I'll think about it is if you get me Grauman's Chinese Theater, because I really dig that place. You know, it's a great place. And so I thought, oh, they'll never get it, and of course they got it, right? They said, okay, you can have Grauman's Chinese Theater. And then I said, all right, well, now I have to have a piece of film to show at the theater, because it's not enough to just show clothes. So Douglas, the guy I was living with at the time, or dating anyway, just started filming me because he thought it would be smart. And that's how it got started. We filmed a lot too much, but we created this little clip that everybody liked a lot at that fashion show in Los Angeles. And he didn't stop filming, he just wouldn't stop, right? So eventually we had like 2 years worth of footage, and he started editing it. Nothing could stop him from editing this. And I encouraged it, and I said, go on. And we raised money, and we did all this nonsense, and I took trips to Los Angeles, where actually people thought I was talking about, like, wet t-shirt videos. Like, promise you. I was like, no, it's a documentary. It's really funny. And they were like, you mean like what? Like a wet T-shirt video that gets shipped with like, you know, Sports Illustrated or something. I mean, I swear to God. Anyway, it got made. And that's how it got made. Again, not at all expecting anything from it. And now it's like, you know, a good thing. It was a good thing. What are the questions? Oh. Well, I mean, you know, you just asked the question and answered it at the same time. Congratulations. You said, like, how could we not get sucked? Just don't. I mean, just put your foot down. Put your foot down. Get a nice Christian Louboutin shoe and put your foot down. Right? And just say, I'm not going to do that. I don't know what is good about that stuff. I really don't. I don't know what's good about it. I don't even know how to do it. And people try to send me emails. I can't even open attachments. I'm really pathetic. Because there is something about sketching, and there is something about painting sketches, by the way. Painting is really great when you work with sketches. And there is something about knowing how to drape things. And I was talking about this before. It's like outsourcing. Oh, my God. And yet, it's very important to learn that, too. You should learn everything. You should learn everything. And that's what was good. That was what was great about working for Target and working with Target, right? Because we didn't know that much about outsourcing, luckily. And we'd say, like, no, this is not good enough. Do it again. Do it, you know, like, we really did force these people to, you know, to make really good clothes. And then when we worked for Liz Claiborne and now we work for QVC, we really have a good way, you know, it's like a fantastic lexicon or language or whatever of working with outsourcing. Do you know what I mean? So, yes, put your foot down, but keep an open mind. Do you know, can you do that? Yeah. It helps when you have a mentor or someone that you look up to who teaches you that. Do you know? And as I said, I had Perry Ellis, and he was a great mentor. I don't even think he knew he was mentoring me. I don't even think he knew I was alive, basically. But except for the fact that he used to take us out to dinner sometimes, and then he would know I was alive. Do you know? Okay, what else is there? What other questions? Oh. My last one is always my best one, and always the culmination of my best work. I mean it. That's my only answer. I can't answer that question any other way. And it's so funny. It's like people think that, you know, that the most important dress I've ever done was X or Y or Z, and I think, no, the most important dress I ever did was the plainest, littlest, most original that everybody missed, you know? That everybody missed, like, will be missed forever, but it was the most important dress. Like, nobody even realizes I did it, you know? That's fine. Too bad, you know? Doesn't make that much sense. It really doesn't. I'll tell you that much. Does not make that much sense. What other questions are there? Oh, that lady. Well, I mean, it's a challenge in that you get to, like, get on a camera and go, ladies, you know, look at this beautiful thing and look how little it costs for 3 easy payments or whatever it is. You know what I mean? It's just, it's so fantastic. And you have, like, this wonderful person that you work with. I love television. Television, I can't get enough television. Are you kidding? I mean, I love movies. I love old movies and I love books. I'm a big reader. And I love music and I've worked in the theater a lot and I've worked in the ballet a lot. You know, I told you I went to performing arts high school. I was really kind of, you know, I learned to read Shakespeare when I was 12. That's great. I would tell everybody to learn to read Shakespeare because it's not something that comes to a lot of people. You do have to learn it, you know. But I love television. I love it passionately. It saved my life. I'm sort of an insomniac. And, you know, when I was a kid, like, I was an insomniac, and no one could tell whether it was because I was staying up to watch TV or because I couldn't fall asleep that I had the TV. I mean, it was a crazy thing. And it was taken away, and it was horrible. My life went mad for however many hours they wouldn't let me watch TV. But, you know, so it sort of saved my life. I feel a real sort of connection with the whole medium of television. So I tell you, it's a big challenge to, like, go on there and say, this is the best thing you could get for the money. And it isn't until now that I actually feel I can say that. Like, I don't know if anyone out there is a perfectionist. I tend to think there are a lot of perfectionists out there. Yeah. And it's like, in the beginning, you go like, oh, God, this is the best thing you could get. Oh, it's the best. And it really isn't, because you didn't make it with your own hands and you didn't. You know what I mean? There's a thread hanging. Oh, God, it's the best thing. You know, whatever. But now I actually do believe that it is the best stuff in the world. If you go on and get that stuff, you won't believe how good it is. I mean, that's a lifetime of experience in those products. It's great. It's great stuff. If it's a cheesecake, I don't care what it is you buy. You can buy cheesecakes now from me, which are incredibly good. They're incredibly good. Sorry. Okay, up there. Yes, I would. I would say that the exposure to the media has strengthened my brand image. If you had asked me that 10 years ago, I would have said, I don't know. But now I would say yes. It's, again, I didn't do it because I wanted it to strengthen my brand image. I did it because I bore very easily and I have to have several different things to work on. And I started making this, I kind of lost my company in 1998 or whatever that was. And I was so happy. I was so happy. And people were calling me, oh my God, you poor thing. I was like, I'm thrilled, right? Because I was already making this television show for Oxygen, and I was really pouring a lot of my sort of guts into that show, and it was a great show. It was a really great show. We made that show for about 3 years, and I learned a lot. And people said, oh, do you think this is strengthening your brand image? And I was like, what brand? What are you talking about? I'm just doing it because I like doing it, right? And I did that show. I wrote that one-person show, and I performed that for a long time on Off-Broadway. And it was great. I still think of that time as being, like, maybe the best time of my life, you know? And then the Target thing came up, and it seemed so great. It seems like such a perfect way to kind of, you know, change the world in some way without changing the world, just admitting certain things were true, you know? Like, cheap clothes are great sometimes. And then, so you see what I mean. It's like, and weirdly, by the way, all that media I did, all those years, I did a style TV show for 2 years. I did my Oxygen show for 3 years. I did my Off-Broadway show. I wrote a comic book. I wrote a book called How to Have Style. All that does not equal like 1/10 of the ad campaign that Target did to launch the collection. I mean, like, people stop me on the street still and go, I love your clothes for Target. I'm like, I'm not in Target anymore, you know, so. It's funny, that will never. That's like indelible in the culture now. Ice cream's ready for Target. It's like people just are, you know, they're in denial that I don't make clothes for Target anymore. Oh, what's your question? Yeah. In an industry that's so big, I think that's my phone. Oh, yes, it is. No, I can't take it. I couldn't possibly. But it's making so much noise, I don't know what to do. It'll still make this noise. All right. Well, how do you stand out? I don't know. I can't, honestly. Okay, now I can make it stop because I missed it. Now I can just open it and it'll stop. Okay, fine. Sorry about that. God. But I have a really kind of, I don't mean this to sound off. It's the truth. If you have to think about that, I think you're in the wrong business. Do you know what I mean? Because, like, Lady Gaga doesn't have to think about how to make herself stand, you know what I mean? Or Alexander McQueen did not have to think about that thought. But then, neither does Costa, what's his name? Someone Costa who does Calvin Klein? Victor Costa, what? Francisco Costa, exactly. He doesn't have to, and he's the quietest of all people. Do you know what I mean? And we notice him. So don't worry. Don't worry about that. It's not about standing out. It's just about sort of doing exactly what you do. Do what you do. And at your age, it will get noticed. You know what I mean? It's like later you have to think about that, I think, maybe, about how to keep getting noticed. That is a drag, I have to tell you. That is a drag. But now, don't think about it. Just think about doing the purest version of what you do. One more question. Yeah, that's a really good question. That's a good question. You know, I have to say, I'm sorry, what? I'm sorry, did you, huh? Oh yeah, it's a good question. I would have to say the answer to that is like, you know, it's a simple thing and it's gonna sound really like it's not the answer, but it is persistence. Right? Repeating and just doing it, just, you know, like hang in there, just keep doing it. And eventually, like, critical mass will occur. You know what I mean? Like, you have like enough handbags to have a handbag business, you have enough dresses to have a dress business, you have enough shoes to actually have a shoe business. You know what I mean? And it just all hangs together in this kind of critical mass kind of a way. So you can't give up, just don't give up. Tenacity. Like on Celebrity, whatever, Donald Trump, that show, Tenacity, isn't that their name? Isn't that like Cyndi Lauper's like name for her? No one watches that? The Celebrity Apprentice? You don't watch The Celebrity Apprentice, you see television. I think that's it. I think that's all we have time for, right? It's 5. Huh? I think that's it. Okay. Thank you, kids. It was really fun.